In this video, we will discuss electrical conductivity in metals. Contents of this discussion are classical free electron theory, failures of classical free electron theory, quantum free electron theory, Fermi energy, and successes of quantum free electron theory. First, we will consider electrical conductivity in metals based on classical theory. We know that metals are good conductors of heat and electricity. Such a high conductivity is due to the presence of free electrons in the metals. According to the classical free electron theory, a metal can be considered to be made up of ionic cores, which consists of nucleus and inner electrons excluding the valence electrons. The ionic cores are here marked here, metal ions, or which are known as ionic cores, which are obtained by the removal of the valence electrons from the neutral atom. The ionic cores are immobile and do not take part in the conduction process. The valence electrons are considered to be free and almost independent of the ions to which they belong. These valence electrons can move under the influence of an applied electric field and hence contribute to the conductivity. The different terminologies used: thermal velocity, the velocity with which the free electrons keep moving due to the thermal agitation. Its unit is meter per second and it is denoted by VTH. Mean free path, the notation used is lambda, the average distance traveled by the conduction electrons between two successive collisions with the lattice ions. Its unit is meter. Mean collision time, tau, the average time that elapses between two successive collisions of the conduction electron with the lattice ions. Its unit is second. Relaxation time, tau r, the time interval required for reducing the average velocity of 1 by e times its value just when the field is turned off. Its unit is also second. Current density, capital J, the current per unit area of cross section of an imaginary plane held normal to the direction of current in a current carrying conductor. That is, J is equal to I by A, where I is the current, A is the area of the cross section. Its unit is ampere per meter square. Electric field, capital E, the potential drop per unit length of a conductor across a homogeneous conductor. That is, E is equal to V by L, where V is the potential drop, L is the length of the conductor. Its unit is volt per meter. Resistivity, rho, it gives the measure of opposition offered by the material during the current flow in it. Resistivity is given by RA divided by L, where R is the resistance, A is the area of cross section, L is the length of the conductor. Its unit is ohm meter. Conductivity, sigma, the physical property that characterizes the conducting ability of a material, and it is given by sigma is equal to reciprocal of resistivity, that is 1 by rho, or equal to L divided by RA. Its unit is per ohm meter. Drift velocity, VD, the net displacement per unit time is called drift velocity. When an electric field is applied, there will be a net displacement in the randomly moving free electrons positions with time in a direction opposite to the direction of the applied field. Drift velocity is constant in a steady state and accounts for a current in the direction of the field. It is given by the equation Vd is equal to EE tau divided by m, where E is charge of the electron and capital E is applied field, m is mass of the electron, its unit is meter per second. Mobility of electrons, mu, the magnitude of the drift velocity acquired by the electrons per unit applied field, that is, mu is equal to Vd divided by capital E. Vd is the drift velocity, E is the applied field. It represents the ease with which the free electrons could drift in the material under the influence of an electric field. Its unit is meter square per volt second. Next, we will consider assumptions of classical free electron theory. There are four assumptions. First one, in a metal, there are freely moving valence electrons called free electrons confined to its body. They are responsible for conduction under the applied field and hence referred to as conduction electrons. Second one, the free electrons are treated as equivalent to gas molecules and thus they are assumed to obey the laws of kinetic theory of gases. The energy associated with each electron at a temperature T is given by 3 by 2 kT, where K is Boltzmann constant. Thus, we can use the equation half m Vth square equal to 3 by 2 kT, where Vth is the thermal velocity or RMS velocity, that is root mean square velocity. Third assumption, the electric potential due to the ionic cores is taken to be constant throughout the body of the metal. And fourth one, the repulsive force between the free electrons and attractive force between the free electron and the lattice ions are considered insignificant. Based on these assumptions, we will get the expression for the electrical conductivity as sigma is equal to n e square tau divided by m, where n is electron concentration, that is number of free electrons per unit volume of the material, e is electron charge, tau is mean collision time, and m is mass of the electron. Next, we will consider failures of classical free electron theory. First one, temperature dependence of electrical conductivity. According to the assumption of classical free electron theory, we have the equation 3 by 2 kT is equal to half m Vth square, which gives, or from this equation we can write Vth is equal to square root of 3 kT divided by m. So this is the equation by rearranging the terms of this equation. That is, Vth is proportional to square root of T because 3, K and M are constant. K is Boltzmann constant, M is mass of the electron, and consider this as equation 1. We know that mean collision time tau is inversely proportional to the thermal velocity Vth. That is, tau is proportional to 1 by Vth, or tau is proportional to 1 by square root of T because Vth is proportional to square root of T, that is from this equation 1. So we can write tau is proportional to 1 by square root of T. We know that from classical theory, the expression for electrical conductivity sigma is equal to n e square tau divided by m, or we can write sigma is proportional to tau because n is electron concentration is constant for a given metal, E is charge of the electron, M is mass of the electron. So sigma depends only on the mean collision time tau. Therefore, sigma is proportional to 1 by square root of T, that is using this equation, that is equation 2. Tau is proportional to 1 by square root of T. Sigma is proportional to tau. So using this equation and this equation, we can write sigma is proportional to 1 by square root of T, that is the electrical conductivity is inversely proportional to the square root of temperature. But experimentally, it is observed that for metals, electrical conductivity is inversely proportional to the temperature T. That is, sigma is 1 divided by T. This is the contradiction. Experimentally, this is the equation, but theoretically, this is the equation. So, this is one of the failures. Second one, dependence of electrical conductivity on electron concentration. From the classical theory, we have sigma is n e square tau divided by m, that is, sigma is proportional to n. But Practically, it is not always true. It is observed from the given table. Now, if you consider the some of the examples here, if you observe the copper, the N value is 8.54 into 10 to the power 28. For silver, N value is 5.85 into 10 to the power 28. That is, N for copper is greater than that of silver. According to this classical theory, what we can say, sigma, that is conductivity, is high for copper compared to that of silver. But the observation, see here, the sigma value for copper is 5.88 into 10 to the power 7 and that of silver is 6.3 into 10 to the power 7. Conductivity of silver is greater than that of copper. Here N is more for copper, sigma is less. So with respect to this copper and silver, this equation is not true. Sigma is not proportional to N. Similarly, if you consider the example of zinc and cadmium, in this case N for sigma is zinc is 13.10 into 10 to the power 28 and that of cadmium is 9.28 into 10 to the power 28. Similarly, sigma conductivity is 1.09 into 10 to the power 7 for zinc and 0.15 into 10 to the power 7 for cadmium. So N is high in case of zinc, similarly sigma is also high. But hence, with respect to zinc and cadmium, sigma is proportional to N. With respect to copper and silver, it is not. That is the conclusion. Practically, it is not true always. Sometimes it is true, but some other time it is not true. Hence, we can conclude that sigma is not proportional to N always. So these are the main two drawbacks of classical free electron theory. Quantum free electron theory. Applying the quantum mechanical principles, Arnold Sommerfeld succeeded in overcoming many of the drawbacks of classical free electron theory. The assumptions of quantum free electron theory are, first one, the energy values of the conduction electrons are quantized. The allowed energy values are realized in terms of set of energy values. Second one, the distribution of the electron in the various allowed energy levels occurs as per Pauli's exclusion principle. According to Pauli's exclusion principle, no two electrons will have the same quantum number. Third one, the electrons travel in a constant potential inside the metal but stay confined within its boundaries. And fourth one, the attractive force between electron and lattice and repulsive force between electrons are ignored. Density of states. The permitted energy levels for electrons in a solid material will be in terms of bands. Each band is spread over an energy range of few electron volts. The number of energy levels in each band will be extremely large. Because of such a huge number, in small energy range, the energy values appear to be continuous as bands spread. The energy levels are not evenly distributed in the band. The number of energy levels per unit energy range varies with the energy along the band. The exact dependence of density of energy levels in the energy is realized through a function known as density of state function, G of E. It is the number of available states per unit volume per unit energy centered at a given energy E in the valence band of a material. If the energy range delta E, the density of state function is given by G of E dE. It gives the number of states per unit volume in the energy interval dE at E. So here E is the reference energy. And then dE is the small energy interval at E. So within this energy interval, the energy levels are distributed uniformly. Hence, it is easy to calculate the density of state function G of E dE. Based on these quantum mechanical concepts, g of E dE is given by 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into e to the power half dE. Here we know m is mass of the electron, h is Planck's constant. From this equation, it is clear that number of energy states in an energy interval dE is proportional to square root of E, because m, h, pi, etc. are constants. That is, g of E is proportional to square root of E. The graph of g of E versus E is as shown. Fermi energy. We know that for a metal containing n atoms, there will be n allowed energy states in each band. As per Pauli's exclusion principle, each energy level can accommodate a maximum of 2 electrons, one with spin up and other with spin down. Any system always tries to be in the state of lowest energy state. The conduction electron stars occupying each of the allowed levels starting from the lowest one. The energy of the level corresponding to the highest occupied state at absolute zero is called Fermi energy. It is denoted by EF and the corresponding level is Fermi level. That is, here in this diagram, this represents the valence band. So there are different energy levels are marked, and these black dots represents the free electrons. The distribution of these free electrons is according to Pauli's exclusion principle. The maximum number of electrons in each level is 2 only. So at absolute zero temperature, this is the distribution. Then the energy of the highest occupied level, this level energy is the Fermi energy EF, and the corresponding level is known as the Fermi level. Thus, at T equal to 0 Kelvin, all the energy levels above the Fermi level are completely empty and those below the Fermi level are completely filled. That we can observe here. Below this Fermi level, all are occupied, completely filled. Above this, all levels are completely empty. Fermi Dirac statistics. In a metal, there will be a very large number of free electrons, and each one of them can possess energy corresponding to any of the energy states in the valence band. But number of energy states available will be much more than the number of free electrons. Therefore, no odd lines is expected. However, there exist odd lines in the energy possessed by the electron when the temperature is the same throughout the body. That is, under thermal equilibrium, the free electrons acquires energy obeying the statistical rule known as Fermi-Dirac statistics. Fermi-Dirac statistics is applicable to the assembly of particles which obey the Pauli's exclusion principle. They must also be identical particles of spin half and are indistinguishable. Since electrons satisfy these conditions, these electrons obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. Fermi-Dirac statistics permits the evaluation of probability of finding electrons occupying energy levels in a certain energy range. Their evaluation is done through a function called Fermi factor F of E. Fermi factor. At the temperature above the absolute zero, that is T greater than 0 Kelvin, the conduction electrons redistributed within the different energy levels. This redistribution is statistical in nature and studied using the function known as Fermi factor F of E. It is given by the equation F of E equal to 1 divided by e to the power E minus EF divided by KT plus 1, where E is the energy of the energy level, EF is the Fermi energy, K Boltzmann constant, T absolute temperature. The Fermi factor is the probability of occupation of a given energy state for a material in thermal equilibrium. Dependence of Fermi factor on temperature and energy. We know that Fermi factor is given by F of E equal to 1 by e to the power e minus ef by kt plus 1. Mark this as equation 1. First condition, case, probability of occupation for e less than ef at t equal to 0 Kelvin. Temperature is 0 Kelvin. Energy considered is less than the Fermi energy. The energy levels are below this Fermi level. When T equal to 0 Kelvin and E less than EF, we have from this equation, here T equal to 0, so this equation becomes E minus EF by KT becomes infinity. Hence, it is 1 divided by E to the power minus infinity plus 1. Why it is minus infinity? E is less than EF. So, E minus EF is negative. That is, f of e is equal to 1 by 0 plus 1, e to the power minus infinity is 0, or f of e equal to 1 for e less than ef. Or, we can say that all the energy levels below the Fermi level are completely occupied at t equal to 0 Kelvin. That we can observe in this diagram also. Second case, probability of occupation for e greater than ef at t equal to 0 Kelvin. Here, when t equal to 0 Kelvin and E greater than EF, again from the equation 1, we can write f of E is equal to 1 by E to the power infinity plus 1. Here it is plus infinity because E is greater than EF. Or f of E is equal to 1 by infinity because E to the power infinity is infinity. Or f of E equal to 0 for E greater than EF, or all the energy levels above Fermi level are completely empty at T equal to 0 Kelvin. Here, E is greater than EF, that is, energy levels are above the Fermi level. That energy levels are completely empty when T equal to 0 Kelvin. Third case, probability of occupation at ordinary temperature, that is, T is greater than 0 Kelvin. At ordinary temperatures, though the value of the probability remains 1 for E much less than EF, and it starts decreasing from 1 as the value of E becomes closer to EF. When E is equal to EF, we have E to the power E minus EF by KT equal to 0, because E equal to EF, or it is equal to 1. Hence, we can write F of E is equal to 1 divided by 1 plus 1, or equal to half. Further, if you increase the energy further, E greater than EF, the probability values falls off gradually from this half. So, variation of F of E for all three cases are shown here. F of E versus energy, and this is 0, and this represents the Fermi energy EF. And when T equal to 0 Kelvin, here, this is the graph. From 0 to EF, F of E is equal to 1, this one. When energy is greater than EF, in this range, F of E equal to 0. Here it is 0. So, it is a step function. Similarly, when T is greater than 0 Kelvin, it decreases gradually from 0. When E is equal to EF, F of E becomes half and it decreases further gradually. So, this curve represents T is greater than 0 Kelvin. Expression for Fermi energy at 0 Kelvin, which is denoted as EF naught. Let the number of electrons per unit volume which possesses energy only in the range E and E plus dE be n of E dE. Then n of E dE is given by the product of number of available energy states in the energy range E and E plus dE and the probability of occupation of those energy levels by the electrons. If G of E dE, the density of state function, represents the number of available energy states in the energy range E and E plus dE, and f of e, the Fermi factor, represents the probability of occupation of any given energy state by the electron, then we can write n of e dE is equal to g of e dE into f of e. This is equation 1. The number of electrons per unit volume of the material n can be evaluated by integrating the equation 1 from e equal to 0 to e equal to e maximum, where e maximum is the maximum energy possessed by the electrons. That is, n is equal to integral 0 to e maximum n of e dE, or n is equal to 0 to e maximum g of e into f of e dE. That is equation 2, and this is obtained by from equation 1, that is substituting for n of e dE. We know that g of e dE is equal to 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into e to the power half dE, and at t equal to 0 Kelvin, f of e is equal to 1. Then we can write equation 2, that is n is equal to integral 0 to e maximum g of e f of e dE, as n is equal to 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube integral 0 to e maximum e to the power half d. That is, n is equal to 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into 2 by 3 e to the power 3 by 2 with limits 0 to e maximum. So this is the integral of e to the power half d. And mark this as equation 3. At t equal to 0 Kelvin, the maximum energy that any electron of the material can have is EF0, that is from the Fermi energy concept. Hence, E maximum is equal to EF0. Substitute this in equation 3, we get N is equal to 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into 2 by 3 e to the power 3 by 2 with the limits 0 to EF0. That is, n equal to 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into 2 by 3 EF0 to the power 3 by 2. Or, EF0 to the power 3 by 2 is equal to h cube divided by 8m to the power 3 by 2 into 3n by pi, rearranging the previous equation. Or EF0 equal to h square divided by 8m into 3n by pi whole to the power 2 by 3. From this equation, we can write like this. Now put B is equal to h square by 8m into 3 by pi to the power 2 by 3, which is equal to 5.85 into 10 to the power minus 38. Now, this is because h is constant, that is Planck's constant, 6.62 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. M is mass of the electron, 9.13 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. Pi is also constant. Hence, this term is a constant, which is equal to this. Now, substituting this as B in this equation, we get EF0 is equal to 5.85 into 10 to the power minus 38 into n to the power 2 by 3. Or EF0 is equal to B into n to the power 2 by 3 joule. Note, Fermi energy at T greater than 0 Kelvin is given by EF is equal to EF0 into 1 minus pi square by 12 into KT divided by EF0 whole square. At ordinary temperature, the term pi square by 12 into KT divided by EF0 whole square is very small compared to 1. Hence, this term can be neglected in this equation. And then we can write EF is equal to EF0 for all practical calculation purpose. Fermi temperature TF. The temperature at which the average thermal energy of the free electron in the solid becomes equal to Fermi energy at 0 Kelvin. When T is equal to TF, TF is Fermi temperature, KTF is equal to EF0. KTF is thermal energy, EF0 is Fermi energy at 0 Kelvin. But we know that for all practical purposes, EF0 is equal to EF. Hence, we can write KTF is equal to EF or TF is equal to EF by K, where K is Boltzmann constant. Fermi temperature is the theoretical concept because if EF is equal to 5 electron volt, then TF is equal to 66,000 Kelvin. So this is calculated using this equation. At this temperature, system is no longer in the solid form. Hence, TF is an ideal concept or theoretical concept. Fermi velocity VF. The energy of the electrons which are at the Fermi level is EF. The velocity of the electrons which occupy the Fermi level is called Fermi velocity VF. That is, EF is equal to half m VF square, or VF is equal to 2 EF divided by m to the power half. Effective mass m star, the mass of the electron when the metal is subjected to the influence of an electric field. It is different from its true mass. Expression for electrical conductivity based on quantum theory. Conductivity of a free electron based on quantum theory is given by sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf, where m star effective mass of the electron, Vf Fermi velocity, n electron concentration, e charge of the electron, and lambda mean free path. Next, we will consider successes of quantum free electron theory. First one, temperature dependence of electrical conductivity. The experimentally observed fact that the electrical conductivity sigma depends inversely to the temperature, that is, sigma is proportional to 1 by T. But according to classical free electron theory we discussed earlier, it depends on temperature as 1 by square root of T. It can be explained as follows. According to quantum free electron theory, electrical conductivity sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf. Mark this as equation 1. Here, Vf is independent of the temperature, but lambda depends on temperature. Vf is Fermi velocity, will not depend on temperature, but lambda, mean free path, depends on temperature. We know that waves associated with the electrons are subjected to scattering by the vibrating ions of the lattice. If R is the amplitude of that vibration, then mean free path of the electron lambda is proportional to 1 by pi r square. Lambda and area of that cross section are inversely proportional to one another. Mark this as equation 2. Also, we know that the energy of a vibrating body is proportional to the square of the amplitude. Energy of ions is due to thermal energy. Thermal energy is proportional to the temperature. Combining all these three points, we can write R square, that is square of the amplitude, is proportional to temperature. Therefore, lambda is proportional to 1 by T, that is from equation 2. That is, equation 2 is lambda is proportional to 1 by R square. R square is proportional to T, hence we can write lambda is proportional to 1 by T, that is equation 3. From equation 1, that is this equation, expression for electrical conductivity, we have sigma is proportional to lambda here. N is constant, that is electron concentration, E charge of the electron, M star effective mass of the electron, Vf Fermi velocity. So all these are constants except lambda. Hence sigma is proportional to lambda. So sigma is proportional to lambda, and from equation 3 lambda is proportional to 1 by t. So from this equation and this equation we can write sigma is proportional to 1 by t. This is in agreement with the experimental observation. Thus, dependence of electrical conductivity on temperature can be correctly explained on the basis of quantum free electron theory. Second success, electrical conductivity and electron concentration relation. According to quantum free electron theory, again we have sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf. Electrical conductivity depends both on n and lambda by Vf ratio. N is electron concentration and ratio of this depends both the terms. If we compare the copper and aluminium, the value of N for aluminium is 2.13 times higher than that of copper, but the value of lambda by Vf for copper is 3.73 times higher than that of aluminium. Thus, the conductivity of copper exceeds that of the aluminium. This ratio is more for copper, hence the conductivity of copper is greater than that of aluminium. The questions from these discussions. First one, mention the expression for electrical conductivity based on classical free electron theory. Second one, explain the failures of classical free electron theory. Third one, define density of state function and give its expression. Fourth one, define Fermi factor and discuss the variation of Fermi factor with the temperature and energy. Fifth one, mention the assumptions of quantum free electron theory. Sixth one, mention the expression for electrical conductivity based on quantum free electron theory. Seventh, define Fermi energy and derive an expression for Fermi energy at 0 Kelvin. 8. Discuss the successes of quantum free electron theory. Thank you.